Back to the big issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Sorry for that technical glitch that we had recently. I was still saying that we are actually losing 20 billion trillion Uganda shillings, according to a survey conducted by the Office of the Inspectorate of Government. Now, also the Transparency International perception, corruption perception, puts Uganda 144th position out of 188 in least corrupt countries in the world. What explains that, and what explains the rising corrupt tendencies within our country? There is an institution of the Inspectorate of Government. What are they doing? What are their rules? And why is it so hard to combat these practices? Now, joining me and my guest to discuss that is Dr. Patricia Achan Okiria, is the Deputy Inspector General of Government. A very good morning, Doctor, and welcome to Big Issue.
Good morning, and good morning, viewers out there.
First of all, for the benefit of our viewers, may need to know what exactly is corruption. Let's start from there before we get into the issues that actually your office deal with.
Well, corruption has a broad definition. Mm. And when you look at the Anti-Corruption Act of 2009, it defines corruption using its characteristics. Corruption is that illicit enrichment, it is bribery, it is abuse of office, it's getting involved in anti-money laundering and many other several offenses. Mm. So corruption is described by its characteristics within the law. And there are penalties for each of those offenses of corruption. Mm. So if someone acquires property not belonging to him illicitly, that amounts to corruption. If someone takes a bribe from another to induce his actions or decisions in the process of doing his work, then that amounts to corruption. Mm. If someone does not keep time and comes to office late,
that's corruption.
Or leaves his jacket in office and goes away.
We started
because
actually 10 minutes
day,
past.
He needs a full pay at the end of the month. So that is corruption. Mm. So when you say that study says our findings, we lose over 20 trillion. Well, from that study conducted by the Inspectorate of Government, it's approximately 9.3 trillion, not 20. But when you add up the overt and covert corruption, it's estimated that it could be over
that amount.
About 20 trillion, yes.
What are
those
covert?
Because we look at overt and covert. Mm. Overt corruption, what we see, the cases we handle. Mm. Covert, what we don't see. Like someone is paid to teach and it just doesn't appear in classroom. Mm. Someone is paid a full salary to do his work and is just absconds from duty. Mm. So that is a kind of corruption. And then in the environment, in tourism, and so
how is it related to environment and tourism? I mean, I don't see a link between, because actually the simplistic definition of corruption, actually many people think about bribery and money theft.
Corruption is broad. Mm. From the environmental perspective, if people are plumbing trees to burn charcoal or export that timber illegally in the night, that is corruption. Because at the end of the day, we see different weather patterns simply because things are not balanced in the environment. That is corruption. At the end of the day, it still affects the citizen. When people say now there are hailstones in Tororo Kwapa, rains have disappeared, the weather patterns are not, it's as a result of corruption.
What
so
triggered?
It's until we change our mindset and begin to respect one another and begin to promote the values and principles and have a patriotism and think about our country.
Then we'll get to the survey, but before I get you to the details of the survey, what are your roles as the Inspectorate of Government?
Well, as the Inspectorate of Government, we derive our mandate from the Constitution. And within the Constitution, our role is to foster strict adherence to the principles of natural justice in the administration of public resources. Then we're supposed to promote good governance in public offices. We're supposed to stimulate awareness, carry out awareness.
Good governance?
Yes.
Are you political in nature or what?
Well, I do not know your intention, Mubarak.
No,
but the inspectorate
I'm
of
not
government,
corrupt for
the inspectorate
sure
of
on
government
that.
Is an institution of the state within the executive.
But when you say, when you talk about good governance, what comes to our mind is politics.
Well, when you look at corruption and governance, there is a close link. I did my master's in democratization in Africa, in human rights and democratization in Africa, and we covered governance. It's broad, touches on corruption and abuse of office issues. It touches on issues of administration of justice. It touches on issues to do with governance, the administrative arrangement to manage a state, the roles of the executive, the judiciary, and the parliament.
Isn't that getting into details of partisan politics, for example?
Well, when
you're using your office actually to maybe...
Not using the office. I've said our mandate is derived from the constitution. And if the constitution says we're supposed to promote good governance in public office, it is even related to the work of the ombudsman. We are the voices of the people. If there is no proper service delivery by those holding public institutions, then it becomes our responsibility to ensure that the people in those offices are carrying out their responsibilities as provided for within the law. So the mandate is not that we are political, it is provided for within the constitution, and we enforce the work of the executive.
Looking at the records, your office has been in existence for quite a long time, since 1988.
Yes.
But actually these cases are still on the rise. Does that actually suggest or point to the fact that there is some kind of also corruption within your office, that actually you cannot erase this monster called corruption in our country?
Well, Mubarak, in every basket of apples you could find three or four rotten apples. But like you have rightly said, corruption is growing by day. It might be a perception because people are getting more enlightened, more aware as a result of the massive awareness programs we are conducting. But also, it might be true that it is actually on the increase. Because when you look at poor supervision in government, syndicate corruption by various government officers. For instance, in the area of procurement, the investigations we have been conducting lately shows that there is now syndicate corruption, low or no demand for accountability. And citizens are not taking part in the fight against corruption, and there is apathy out there. So that shows that corruption is actually getting syndicate, and which means that we need to derive new innovative mechanisms of dealing with corruption. And that is the reason why for us in the inspectorate, our strategy now is actually preventive. We want to encourage preventive mechanisms, inculcate the people with knowledge about the dangers of corruption, the effects, the implications of not reporting, and encouraging them to come out and report. Come out and name and shame. Come out and hate.
How effective is your approach? Because recently we used to hear cases of IGG, proposing and also suggesting and recommending to interdict officials. But under your reign, we don't see these cases happening. Thieves
well,
seems to
Mubarak,
be going scot-free.
If you took time to study our reports, like recently we submitted our reports to Parliament, you will realize that we have been interdicting. Actually, this week alone, we have ordered for the interdiction of a number of people, including chief administrative officers. Only that perhaps most of what we are doing is behind the scenes, but we are actually ordering the interdiction of people. We have even ordered that some people refund some of the proceeds, some of the monies they have stolen or misused while in those offices. So
you talked about
doing the preventive, but we are also arresting, we are also prosecuting, we are also still investigating. So we are basically doing that.
Why are you so much emphasizing on the preventive? Are you in any way suggesting that maybe your predecessors focus so much on the post-mortem when the money has always been stolen already?
Well, when you look at the preventive, we do not want to measure a lot of confrontational, because we know that when you prepare the citizens out there to know that they're supposed to be part of the war against corruption, then they embrace that and they will contribute because they know that the war is their war and not our war within government. It is more of the people's war. We want to encourage the people to come to us and report cases, to be whistleblowing, to bring issues to our attention so that we take action. So, and at the same time, we are saying, with the cases we already have, we are continuing to investigate, we are continuing to prosecute, we want high conviction rates, so that people can see and know that it is not good to take part in acts of corruption. And that is why we are saying, for us, when we arrest and recover, it is an effective tool in the fight against corruption. Arresting and when someone is banned from holding a public office, it is punitive. It's a punitive approach, because when someone is it's very embarrassing to be arrested by for mismanaging public funds. Recently, I sanctioned arrests of some officials, the principal of Kichwamba Technical Institute, together with his deputy and Basa, for instance. It was not a nice story. It wasn't.
Yeah.
Because if you are charged with responsibility of taking care of an institution and you are the one involved in mismanaging, then it is a very, very absurd story.
Well, we'll get to the issue of citizen participation later in the show. But before we do that, how did you get to a level of conducting a survey that actually came up with this kind of an alarming figure? For example, what was wrong? Because there must have been a problem that actually you must have based on to say, let's conduct a survey. And were these findings really, representing the fact on the ground?
Thank you very much, Mubarak. When we started, you said we are doing badly in terms of corruption.
I did not say you are doing badly.
It is true that we are not doing well as a country in terms of corruption perception indexes. We have continuously scored low. No parent would be happy for a child to come back saying he got 42 or 27.
Are you judged unfairly?
I think it's a perception. It's a perception we need to change. That is why I am saying, for us as the Inspectorate of Government, which is a very key institution, which is the lead institution in the fight against corruption, we have actually engaged with Transparency International. We have analyzed their sources. How do they arrive at that report about our country? We have seen their sources. Now, when you talk about perception, they talk about people's attitude. What do they think about corruption?
But also sometimes people's attitudes actually can as well be accurate.
Yes, they can be accurate, or they can also be inaccurate. Now, when people are informed and made more aware, their attitude, their perception is also different. That is why we insist in the inspectorate that the war against corruption needs to be taken to the people. And our regime, I have just told you that we are now 1 year and one or two months approximately in the Inspectorate of Government. We are working towards changing that perception. Why? We are taking the war to the people. Because it is a citizens' war. When they go to hospital and they don't find drugs in the hospital, it is them who are suffering. So we are saying, so if the citizen is a victim, the citizen has to own the war against corruption, and we fight this war together and change the mindset. Because now that corruption perception index comes from the mindset of the citizens.
Which citizens are actually victims of this corruption?
Yes, who are victims.
Yes,
so we
meaning
are
they are actually,
the
their perception.
Need to join the war against corruption. We need to clean this country up together.
So what was the basis of this survey, yet actually corruption index is showing that our situation is in a dire state?
But Mubarak, I have just said the country has not been doing well. And that is the reason why it triggered that survey. Now, when we get the findings of that survey, it shows us areas which are dirty. Red flag here, red flag here. That is why we have come up with new innovations, like the lifestyle audit, for instance. And then we are doing
which
the
president seemed not comfortable with.
Who said he's not comfortable?
He's on record in Kololo when your boss hinted on it, and the president told him go slow with it.
Well, let me clear the air. When the president said go slow, he said some corrupt people may take investments out of the country, and for us, we have got the national anti-corruption. National anti-corruption authorities we partner with. We have got the African, we have got the regional, sub-regional. So we have got the mutual legal assistance. So when, for instance, you look at the East African anti-corruption authorities, we have got mutual legal assistance. If anyone went to Kenya, Tanzania, or anywhere within East Africa and took the proceeds, we can work together with our partners and be able to get this person repatriated back and brought to book. If he went anywhere in the world, we have got the international anti-corruption authorities, which we partner with. We have attended their sessions. We have even hosted in our country. We have hosted the African Anti-Corruption Association's conference here. And it promotes partnership and strategic alliances in dealing with cases of corruption. So tell me, if somebody took resources illicitly acquired and chose to invest, for instance, in Mauritius, it is just a call away. Sometimes we get into MOUs, we get into strategic agreements in order to deal with some of those issues. Like recently, we are dealing with a case involving Mlago, where some people have invested elsewhere, and some people are alleging that they have relatives elsewhere in the UK who send them the monies to do whatever investments. And we're able to dig and get information using the mutual legal assistance. So for us, the lifestyle audit is basically an investigative approach, a method where someone, if he acquires monies illicitly, they are quick to go and invest in real estate, these big cars, the holidays abroad, and so on. So we investigate and see what triggered the change in this person's lifestyle. And then you're able
That's
to track
into
that money.
Somebody's private life.
You're able
Dr.
to track,
Patricia.
You're able to track, but the law provides for it. It's an investigative approach. The law gives us the mandate to conduct investigations.
Are you not actually
issues
using
of corruption?
Is
so if you're joining the fight against corruption, why should issues of privacy come in?
No, but people actually are entitled to privacy.
Well, someone steals money and takes it to his private coffers. Shouldn't we touch on that? We have the mandate within the law to touch on that. So you're not going to say that, for me, this is my private coffers. We're saying, hey, how did you get all this that you
but
have?
Also this is subject
to... Is it commensurate to your well-known sources of income?
But also this is actually also somehow can as well be abused by your institution and, of course, other corruption, you know, anti-corruption agencies of government. How are you ensuring that actually this lifestyle audit is not abused and targets people because of their political inclinations?
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Mubarak, for bringing that out. Well, the law gives us powers, but we have to use the powers carefully. We have to use those powers cautiously. And that is the reason why we do not just act on rumors. We conduct our clandestine investigations before we actually sanction any arrests. That is the reason why when I halt a certain process from taking place, it has to be within the law. It has to be thought through very carefully so that the implications are not grave. Because if we swing into arrest here, arrest there, arrest here, you find that people will turn around and sue government, and government will lose lots of money. But on the other hand, in the inspectorate, we have been able to recover. We have used the approach to actually recover funds that has been acquired illicitly. So for us, we think it's a method that works. We use our powers within the law, but we also apply those powers cautiously. Because if the law gives me powers to sanction arrests, it doesn't mean that I should go around arresting everybody I find. I have to be very cautious. It has to be within the law.
Do you do internal audits within your office? Because for sure we have seen agencies of government which are meant to be fighting corruption, but actually they are the ones that are promoting it in some places.
Well, the day we took oath, we were cautioned actually by His Excellency the President. Said, clean your house. And we have been, from the time we took office, we're actually cleaning up the inspectorate. You have heard about the organization development assessment. It's a kind of restructuring. We are setting standards. We have rotated our directors. The regional inspectorate officers have been rotated every now and then because we do not want them to get used to the environments they're working in. We do not want them to get compromised. And then another thing we have done, we now have the ad hoc anti-corruption brigades, where you go into a district, do barazas, get feedback from the people, take action on the feedback and have them investigated. Then they return back to do the reports and we proceed.
There is an issue actually that is happening in local governments.
Yes.
We've been receiving so many cases. But before we get to that, there is an issue also of big fish that are not touched, the untouchables in this country.
Yes.
You are calling the public to come and report these people, but certainly this public, how are you protecting them? How are you protecting whistleblowers in this country? Nobody can actually come closer to you, Patricia, because you are so much protected by, you know, the army, the police. Nobody can come close to you, but me,
well.
Mubarak, or a person out there. How sure are you that after reporting this big fish, these untouchables, you are going to actually have a good life afterwards?
Well, it is God who takes care of us all. For you, it's Allah. It actually refers to God.
Mm.
It is important for me to actually clear the air about this so-called big fish, because there's a lot of syndicate corruption, like I had said earlier on, especially within the government institution.
Mm.
And the Inspectorate of Government, we do not do selective investigations or prosecution. We receive information from the people, we receive cases, we receive information from whistleblowers, and we carry out thorough investigations before we take any action. We ensure that we do investigate these cases. We rely on members of the public to aid our work, because they help to provide us with the leads on where to go. They blow the whistle because we are not everywhere. So when we get this, we get evidence, and then we go ahead and prosecute. Some of these people even volunteer to stand as witnesses in these cases. But we do not discriminate between the so-called small cases of corruption or the big cases of corruption. Because corruption, like sin,
but there are many people,
and
actually,
the
they have been talked
about
all the time being talked about, but actually they are left scot-free. And the public knows those people. They are holding very big offices. They keep writing about them in the media, they keep talking about them in social media, but actually nothing is being done.
Something is being done, not nothing. Because normally the big fish, the top government officials, when they are involved in this, they use the technical people. So you find that at the end of the day, when we investigate, we end up with a technical people, because there is no trail linking to them.
Mm.
They give verbal instructions. And that is the reason why you have heard over and again my principal saying the big fish are slippery.
Yes.
Because when you go into trying to follow the trail, you find that all of it is linked to the small people, the technical people. And even when we take matters for prosecution, it's the technical people whom we are actually prosecuting, because they've taken instructions.
Mm.
There is no evidence that they took those instructions.
Yes.
But they had to breach the law, and then we end up getting them instead of the big fish. But what I wanted to say, that big or small, it's all corruption.
Mm.
One by one makes
a
bundle. That's why you can have a sack of mukene.
Mm.
Yes. But when we recover, however small, we know that the recoveries will continue, and small makes big.
Mm.
So at the end of the day, we are proud to register cases of recoveries of billions. Even when it comes from the small fish, the several small fish make big, yes.
But how are you protecting these whistleblowers? Because
when
they offer this information to you, what mechanisms do you have in place to ensure that actually they are protected?
We have the Whistleblower Protection Act. And the Whistleblower Protection Act, the spirit behind that law is to offer protection for whoever discloses any act of impropriety to the Inspectorate of Government.
Mm.
So that law defines who a whistleblower is. A whistleblower has, first of all, to bring information in good faith.
Mm-hmm.
A whistleblower does not blow his own identity. After reporting, then you go all over the place saying you have reported the case. A whistleblower is treated as a whistleblower when he is, when his identity is protected. But we have to distinguish between who a whistleblower is, as defined within the Whistleblower Protection Act, and who an informer is.
Uh-huh.
There are situations where a whistleblower...
I thought a whistleblower is an informer. You just see something happening.
We have provisions within the Anti-Corruption Act, Section 34, which explains exactly who an informer is.
Mm.
Yes. So we have to be clear who is complaining. Is it the whistleblower or the informer?
What
because
is the
whistleblower
what is
a
the
special
fundamental
person
difference?
Who we actually would even rent for, whose identity would hide who would shift from one place to another because we are protecting him within the Whistleblower Protection Act? The informer brings information in good faith as well, and he even discloses his identity. Like we have those cases of people who just bring information, this and this is happening here, and we investigate those cases. Yes.
But
in terms of whistleblower protection,
who qualifies to be that?
A whistleblower is that person who has hidden his identity.
So the informer is
under our protection. An informer is someone who volunteers.
Who volunteers to and
says there's inappropriate happening here, acts of corruption.
And then he's free to disclose his face.
He discloses.
So you are not protecting that person.
That person brings the information in good faith, but that person also requires protection. But the challenge we are having now today, we do not have a witness protection law in our country. We have a draft. We know that the Law Reform Commission is working something out on that together with the Directorate for Ethics and Integrity. It needs to be fast-tracked because we need that law to protect
the informers and the witnesses.
Yeah, because
have you had cases where actually these informers are being targeted?
Well, not during this 1 year while I'm in the office. If I had of any, I would be glad to share. But I know that we are working very well in partnership, even with the civil society organizations. They are free to bring cases to us, like Rwenzori Anti-Corruption Coalition and ACU, you know. They bring cases, they give us information which we take up, we investigate, we prosecute.
Dr. Patricia, there is an issue actually of paying for whistleblowing and paying, you know, there is an amount that you pay to those people who actually give you leads to where this corruption is taking place. How do you handle that situation? And do really people get this money?
Yes, people get that money. People get that money because the law says 5%. So when we have investigated a case and recovered that money, we pay that 5% to the person who brought the information, because it is provided for within the law, both the Anti-Corruption Act and the Whistleblower Protection Act. So it's 5% of what we have recovered. Yes.
So in other words, it's an incentive to those
people. To encourage the people to report cases to us. It's an incentive. Even Uganda Revenue Authority does that.
Yes.
For their informers, they are given, I think it's also 5% within the law.
Yes.
Yes. So that is basically an incentive to encourage the people to come and report cases, to encourage complainants to come and report cases.
If we are to go by percentage, for example, in terms of recoveries, of the money that you recover, what percentage are we at in Uganda?
Well, we have recovered quite, maybe I can make just reference, because if you look at it in terms of the cases we have registered in the inspectorate vis-a-vis the recovery, I think we are doing very well, because we have, since we took office, we have handled approximately 36 high-profile cases and 1,324 other corruption cases involving the Minister of Local Government, involving departments, agencies, and so on. And then these cases have involved a sum of 157 billion. Arising from the investigations, we have directly recovered 18.2 billion from the public offices. And then we have also found culpable of people who are culpable of misuse of government resources. We have been able to acquire about 8 billion, especially into our asset recovery fund. So we have recovered quite an amount of money, and we are still hopeful, because now there are people who opt out of court, and we have an out-of-court settlement.
Yes.
So we say, well, if you cause the loss of this amount, then pay back, and we do not have to go ahead and have you prosecuted. So some people
negotiate with the corrupt.
Some people opt out. It's not like
countries don't negotiate with the terrorists, and with those are actually committing crimes more than terrorism.
It is provided,
but you negotiate with them.
It's provided for within the law for out-of-court settlements. So we reach an agreement, and the person gets to refund what it is they have stolen. Sometimes in the middle of the prosecution, the person admits that he's guilty. And we're like, if you're guilty, then pay back to government what belongs to government.
And then you left scot-free. That's not fair.
Well,
Patricia, the Dr. Patricia, that's
law,
not fair.
I have a doctorate in law and a master's in law as well and a honors degree in law. But if it is provided for rightly within the law,
do you believe that
are backed by
you are
the
a lawyer? Do you believe that?
Yes, I do.
Is it fair? Like you steal some, you steal public money,
you
recover it, and then you are left scot free.
If you can
without any
back,
punishment given
it
to
is
you,
provided for within the law, Mubarak. Law is law. If you are not happy with the provisions of the law, write a brief, an opinion about it, with recommendations that the law should be amended, that whoever steals should not be given an opportunity to refund and should just go and rot in
Dr.
jail.
Dr. Patricia, are you not massaging these corrupt people?
It is not about massaging the corrupt people, but like, well, every human being is subject to his or her opinion. If people have the view that our law is having lenient penalties, then it can be reviewed. It can be reviewed and those penalties made harsher. Because I would be glad also to sanction an arrest prosecution of a person and send the person to jail and, you know, and suffer a harsher punishment. But I'm also happy that if the person is able to bring back that money and it goes back to the public coffers and it is put to good use, then it's a good thing. We need to push for more and more recoveries of the public funds that are misused or lost than just jailing the person. And he's putting on free uniform, yellow, he's not paying rent, and we are feeding him. And then, you know, it's better the person pays back the money and he comes back and plows back. He can
but
do
once that
businesses.
Happens, you stop him from holding a public office.
Yes, we stop him from holding a public office. Actually, the negotiation is that you go, resign, pay back. Pay back. That is why the first thing we do is to interdict the person.
Yes.
If we conclude our investigations, this person is prosecuted and, you know, barred from holding that office again.
Dr. Patricia, let's talk about the cases in local governments.
Yes.
Because we have to wind up this whole conversation. But local governments have become something else. Has the corruption been so much decentralized that these cases have now left the center and now so much evident in local governments? What triggers that? Are we sending a lot of money to local governments, or there are actually no efforts being done to make sure that these practices are not at the district level?
Mubarak, the inspection of government, the Inspectorate of Government has the lead anti-corruption agency in this country, is doing quite a lot, creating awareness, sensitizing the people, empowering the people. But corruption seems to be escalating and escalating. And the reason is we need to look, I think, at something to do with the mindset change. When you look at local
government, the penalties are not that
stringent. When you look
at
local government today, it has become a big problem. Big problem, like you have mentioned. So many cases. Like 3 weeks ago, we interdicted about 6 chief administrative officers from different districts within local government. What does that say? What does that say to us? It is saying, it's raising signals, first of all, that the situation is getting worse.
Even in other districts.
Even in other districts, not just those 6. And then secondly, I think we need new innovative approaches to deal with this. Because like now, even when you look at District Service Commission, you may have heard about District Service Commission selling jobs.
Yes. Are also jobs, giving them to their relatives.
And we are saying, well, we need an
nepotism is
approach.
Really too much.
We need to change the mindset. We need to change the way business is done so that it's not business as usual. And Mubarak, I can assure you that when we catch those people, we will arrest them irrespective of who they are and will have them prosecuted. The only problem is corruption is so covert. Corruption is syndicate. People are complaining, but they're not bringing evidence. It has to be evidence-based. So if we can trap and get somebody getting bribes or selling jobs in the district, then we will be able to deal with those and we will send signals so that other districts have to.
Are these cases in local governments being laid by the district, the political leadership, or the technical wing of those districts?
Both. The instances where both the political and technical are involved. Both the political and technical involved. Like you have been reading about the parish development model.
Yes.
Have you seen that some districts have treated parish development model like it is a cash bonanza?
Yes.
There are instances where we have swung into action and arrested people, had others interdicted, and we are taking them for prosecution because of misusing parish development money. We have instances where people have been asked to pay back and refund that money. Although now I hear you say you are against that. But for us,
no, I'm not against paying back money. I'm against paying back money, but at the same time serving other punishments equally.
Yes.
You don't let that person, because he has refunded the money.
He has refunded and he has lost his job.
No, he has refunded, he has lost his job, also jail. Maybe that's the reason to why most of these efforts, most of the fight against corruption is not actually getting to be addressed because of those gaps in the penalties. Because, for example, if you introduce a death penalty on the corrupt people, because certainly the money they steal in these public offices, they are doing murder. That's really, they are committing murder. Because if you don't find drugs in the hospitals, if you don't teach children, you are literally killing them.
We stop at prosecution. We have got the High Court sentencing guidelines. So when the matter goes to court, then it is the judge, the presiding judge,
to determine
who determines. But for us, if the person can pay back, then we're like, well, we have recovered this into the asset recovery fund and it goes back into the government coffers. That's why we are encouraging more and more. And then also, sometimes court process takes a while. And we are engaging with the...
Which is a very big problem.
Yes, it takes a while. If something is going to go on and adjourn for 10 years, then it is very disheartening. But if matters can be handled expeditiously, which we are pushing for, the beauty about it is that we have got the anti-corruption court, which specifically deals with issues of corruption.
Yes.
And that helps us a lot as the inspectorate. So when we investigate, we are sure that our matters are going to be appropriately handled in the anti-corruption court. So talking about the penalties, I think you're right. The penalties need to be made harsher so that corruption is discouraged heavily out there, because it is now getting worse. It's getting syndicate. And we're not supposed to be lamenting. We've lamented for long. We are supposed to be swinging into action. That's why our new regime, we are actually action-based. We are swinging into action. As I talk to you now, today I'll be going to Ibanda. Ibanda, why? Ibanda happens to be one of the best
performing
districts. And we are going to be having our international and corruption celebrations in Ibanda. We are not saying Ibanda does not have any corruption at all.
They
we are saying that if there are pygmies, Ibanda happens to be
the tallest pygmy.
So we want Ibanda to showcase and tell us what it is it that they did differently in terms of service delivery to the people, in terms of the performing of the districts, in terms of, you know, the services they offer to the people. So the celebrations will be in Ibanda, and we are taking the war against corruption to the people, because we want the people equipped. That is why we have trained community monitoring groups in the villages to be our eyes and report cases. They're the ones who go and see the government projects. If they identify any shoddy work, then they bring it to our attention.
Yeah,
so it is a people's war,
and
we hope that it is going to...
Dr. Patricia, we have to wind up this conversation, but before we do that, I understand, I may agree with you, especially on the Transparency International figures coming out on the perceptions. Certainly corruption is not a Ugandan thing. It's a global problem that certainly happens in many countries. And it is wrong to paint Uganda as if Uganda is the most corrupt nation in this whole world. There are many much worse cases elsewhere in the world. But Dr. Patricia, if you were to recommend, what are those gaps that we need to fill as a country, but also what can as well be done to ensure that we have at least eradicate this monster called corruption in our country?
As a country, I think we now need to target, you know, the old ones are like rotten apples. We need to target the youth. We need to target the educational institutions, the universities. We need to change that mindset and equip them with knowledge to deal with corruption. Because when we talk about corruption perception, okay, I believe this coming year, we are not going to have a bad report on the Corruption Perception Index, probably because of what the Inspectorate of Government has been doing and other interagency forum against corruption.
Yes.
Because we know that when we deal with the youth, when we deal with the citizens out there, when we take this war of corruption to the people and involve the people, then the mindset will change and will probably have, hopefully, a better report from the Corruption Perception Index. Mm. Corruption Perception Index is good because it helps to show us where our weaknesses
yes.
are. Mm. But it is also bad because it discourages investors, because which investor would want to come and invest in our country if it is poorly performing in that area?
Mm.
So we need to change that completely. And we need to work with the youth educational institutions. We need to take this corruption fight to the Omuntu Abulijjo, so that everybody is involved and embraces this war against corruption. And believe you me, the mindset will change, the attitude of the people will change, people will be more patriotic and will think in terms of for the good of their country and not for their own selfish interests.
Absolutely.
Yes.
But also, actually, opposition leaders say that the president doesn't have goodwill to fight corruption.
What would you expect
from
the opposition?
But from what he said on a public television, everybody was like,
Mubarak, I was in cabinet yesterday, and the chair of cabinet has proposed a special cabinet sitting on issues to do with corruption. What does that tell you? It says that there is political will. If the entire cabinet wants to give a whole sitting to discussing issues with corruption, then for me, there is a thumbs up to the leadership.
Are you
safe,
Dr.
Patricia? But what would you expect
Patricia?
Opposition to say? Opposition is always out there, of course, to critique and bring out gaps and shortfalls from the ruling government. But they also remind us about our responsibilities in the fight against
many
corruption.
Actually of the strong women who have fought this kind of people have gone down. They have gunned them down. You remember the Joan Kagezi. Are you scared for your life?
I am not scared at all, because I know
you have many guns around you.
I know it's not about the many guns, by the way. I know that it is God who takes care of me. And I know that if I perform my work diligently with my whole heart, God alone sees my heart and will reward me. But if it is time for me to go, Mubarak, at your door here, I can go. And it's not only the gun, anything else.
What gives you that confidence? The president?
Well, it's not the president. Mm. It's my self-will. I know that if I put out my whole heart to serve this government, my results will speak for themselves. The institution will shine. The mindset of the people will change. And when things change out there, I will be the happiest Ugandan. And I'm telling you, I could even retire tomorrow and say this war against corruption, we have achieved
You're so much articulate.
Yes.
Do you have presidential ambitions?
Not at all. And I don't even have ambitions to be a member of parliament or go into active politics. I am just this ordinary Ugandan who is here to serve our country. And when time comes to go home, I will go home knowing that I contributed.
Because I know you are not a politician.
For you, do you?
I do.
Good luck, Mubarak.
Thank you so much. It's been Dr. Patricia. Okiria, she's the Deputy Inspector General of Government. We've been discussing corruption and what efforts government is putting in place to ensure that this monster called corruption is erased from and eradicated from our government and from our society. It's been the big issue. Coming up next, we are seeing actually action going on in World Cup. What does it feel like to actually represent a national level at such a tournament? Former Cranes keeper Hassan Waswa Mawanda is coming actually up with Miles Ramiti to discuss that feel and who is likely to be the favorite at the World Cup.
Tukutusa kebinyevu
Robito omuntu jibambi buli wabira nalaba munna maulira acha gendera dala masono kwetonda
muziki ku muziki
nyango nyumide mutawa.